We're talking to Dr. Cupid Poe, and the topic is the relationship between religion and health. Dr. Poe, before we had our first commercial break, we wanted to at least give you an opportunity during the second segment to talk about the relationship between religion and health and how it is that folks who seem to be involved in religion one way or the other seem to have better health and well-being and excel. Talk about it from that perspective.
Well, that's a very good question, Dr. Haney, because we still don't know in terms of reproducible laboratory evidence why people who are religious have better mental and physical health. We don't understand the biological or possibly the physiological mechanism or mechanisms underlying this fact. We do know it's a fact based on the available research. Now, it has been suggested that people who are religious probably make better health decisions. They're more likely to go to the doctor when they're sick. They're less likely to smoke. They're less likely to abuse alcohol. They're more likely to take care of themselves. But there are studies that have controlled for what's called health behaviors. And still, people who pray, who attend a place of worship on a regular basis, who attempt to, who have a genuine faith in God, and that's a very important fact, spiritual fact, these people consistently, in most studies now, not in all studies, have better mental and physical health. And let me say that I believe that God is the reason. I believe that whenever I live in a way that's pleasing to Him, He affirms me, He rewards me, if you will, by blessing me with a higher level of mental and physical health. Now, whether we can demonstrate that in the laboratory, I don't know. I'm not bothered if we can't. I'm convinced that God is the reason why people who are religious have better mental and better physical health.
And you think that you can almost find facts of that every Sunday or every time that people gather in terms of religion, some kind of religious service, because that is a testimony that most of them will make. And so so what you're saying is that in spite of the fact that you can't demonstrate it in the laboratory, that you believe that to be true, and that's the point of view.
Absolutely. And absolutely. I think that, for example, the data is so overwhelming. For instance, people who are religious have a much, much lower suicide rate, a much, much lower homicide rate, a much lower rate of alcohol and drug abuse. They have better marriages overall. They have a lower divorce rate. As I said before, they have a better functioning immune system. There was a study done at Duke involving 1,700 elderly people, and they found that people who are religious and who are involved in their church, these people have a lower level of a certain chemical in the blood that's high in persons who are who have HIV/AIDS, and persons who have a certain kind of cancer called lymphoma, and persons who are very advanced in age. All right, so we have scientific data that affirms that people who are religious consistently, and most studies now, not in all, have better mental and physical health.
So, Dr. Poe, what would be your advice? Would it be your advice to people who might be caught up in some kind of health cycle that they need some assistance? It seems that they've gone to the doctor and the doctor has been unable to help them, and et cetera. What would your advice be to them in terms of their health?
Okay. Well, I think one of the things we need to do, Dr. Haney, is we need to train more physicians to utilize, to address the spiritual needs of their patients, to ask questions about it, to assess their patients spiritually. One, does a patient have an active faith in God? Is the patient engaged in a religious activity, church attendance, prayer? Is a person involved in his or her church or temple or a place of worship? Okay, because all of these facts contribute to that person's health. And so we need to do a better job of educating our medical students, our physicians, so that they can become more aware of just how important their patient's faith is in terms of their health. Now, that's a big one.
I know you've talked about this before, Dr. Poe, but now, as a psychiatrist, how do you find members of your own profession reacting to this spiritual assessment that they might have to make? Do they ordinarily think in terms of making a spiritual assessment when they start dealing with their patients?
No, most psychiatrists don't do spiritual assessments. They've not been trained to do spiritual assessments. And I think that, to be honest, I'm sure some of my colleagues are just kind of not open to doing that at this point. Mm-hmm. Dr. Harold Koenig at Duke, who is the foremost researcher in the area of spirituality and medicine, made the point about 4 weeks ago at a conference in Indianapolis on spirituality and healing, that only about 5% of physicians in the U.S. address the spiritual needs of their patients. So you see, we've got a long way to go. But there's good news. In 1972, only three medical schools taught their medical students courses, had a course offering in spirituality and health. As of 2002, there were 72 medical schools out of 125. So we are beginning to make progress in this area, but we've got a long way to go. We've got a long way to go. And so our physicians have not been trained to know, frankly, that the religion of that patient is a major resource, health resource for that patient. And so as a physician, if they're going to practice, if they're going to treat the whole patient, they've got to treat not only the physical dimension of the patient, not only the emotional, the psychological dimension, they also have got to address and relate to the spiritual dimension as well.
Yeah, the holistic approach, is that, would that be a sort of a holistic approach to patient care? How do you pay? You take care of patients, and that
the holistic medicine involves addressing the physical, the emotional, or the psychological, as well as the spiritual.
Okay, and of course, Dr. Poe, we're getting ready for this second commercial break, after which we'll come back and we'll give you an opportunity to give us some more illustrations in reference to what people can do if they find themselves in such situations that healing does not seem to be coming their way. What they might do, and what are some of your suggestions. In other words, to give them a practical information about patient care from a holistic point of view. And of course, after this short commercial break, we will be back with you. We're talking to Dr.